Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Right, welcome to Test Community Session for this week. We've got Tony Bruce in, and Tony is, as well as being the organiser of the London Test Gathering Workshop, he's also a professional experience, constantly learning, coaching and teaching agile team member who specialises in testing. He's worked for a bunch of companies, Channel 4, Ernst & Young, Children's Society, but also a founding member of the International Society for Software Testing. So, Tony knows his stuff. He's going to talk to us today about how to be a real team member, so what it means to work in an agile team. So, without any further ado, I will hand over to Tony.
Right. Very well. John, can you put it up a little bit now?
Yeah.
Hello. Is that better? Is it dropping there? Yeah. Cool. So, as I said, my name is Tony Bruce. I work mainly in NL London. I work in Brighton from here, actually. I work mainly in London. I am essentially a software consultant. I've not really worked out job titles myself, so I'm mainly a software consultant. I focus on testing and people. And because I switch to the team, I can't start looking at what makes a team tick. So this is just a short story about how to be a team from my point of view. So currently I'm an associate with People Experts, who is a software delivery firm. That's my Twitter, that's my blog, and my website. So what we're going to do, this is it. What we're going to look at essentially is, first we're going to look at what makes a good team member. Then we're going to look at different roles around teams. And then we're going to have a look at day-to-day work of how to be a good team member. So one thing I should point out actually is that I have no intention of talking at you for 25 minutes. I'm basically going to start a discussion and ask some questions. And if you don't answer, I'm just going to stand here and be forever. So it's not really short, but I'm interested. A little recap. So, question for you. What makes a good team? Anyone?
Collaboration.
Reliable.
Open communication.
Open communication. There's one more. I'm somewhere there.
Contribution.
Good. One more.
That's knowledge sharing.
Allow to see one more.
Open to criticism.
I think that's what helps. I usually use that as a framework. this is Dr. Bell. He's been around for quite a while. And he basically spent about 30 years, I think it was, just studying genes. And he basically started out with the concept that everyone in the team assumes a role, naturally. Which kind of makes sense to me. And he broke them up. And that's his definition of people. And we're going to go through some of his ideas and see if that makes sense. Because it makes sense to me, at the same time, it isn't what everyone assumes on the person. So he broke it up into three kind of broad classifications. And essentially, there's an action role, a people role, and a thought role. First one up is a plan. Is that real? I'm not going to go through the models about that, but is that real? I'm not going to go through one, that's what I'm saying. Essentially, left is good, right, not so good. You know, resource investigator, so we can be enthusiastic, do better, you know, be over-optimistic, and lose interest in the initial phase of starting. There's the coordinator. You'll probably start recognizing some of these as people you know as well. There's the shaper. And the navigator. And the team. Will these remind you of one another? Yeah, can't say the name. But you can do it if you want, right? And then there's the leaker, is it? Thank you. That's where I'm thinking, my current thinking is. But yeah, sometimes we get too stuck in one area. And as you know, well, what I mean by that is we haven't seen what that two technical areas. We're on to the data set. So this is what I think. That's the thing. So positive action over positive thinking. By that, I mean, we all think about stuff. Usually we don't think about stuff, but we don't actually do anything about it. So we need to think and do. Ask the questions. Has anyone been in a meeting where they kind of long talk about this and kind of think, I must have missed something? Or I must be so simple that I don't want to ask the question. And I'll tell that to you. Come to be honest. And then generally, you'll find that if you ask the question, it's good because no one else has to ask it about it. They're quite nice things. So don't be shy about asking the questions. Just ask the questions all the time. Be like a child, like a 4-year-old child who just says, why? That's all we should do. So we mentioned it before, taking on criticism or feedback. There's a few ways to do it as well. It's a good idea to express what you do want rather than what you don't want. There's probably a long list of stuff that you don't want. So focus on the stuff that you really want, and that's awful as well. The rest are a lot easier with that as well. Obviously avoid vague or abstract or use words or phrases. Be a bit pinpointy, be explicit, or prescribed. And also, you can go with this model, which is just to say, this is what you did, this is what I feel, and this is a need of mine that was met. Which is something that we don't really generally do. Most of the time, we can say, you did a good job. It's nice to hear, it's not very helpful. And then I got to be told that into others, or I like to think that into others. Everyone wants to just go and feedback on the lines of, you did good on that project. Which is nice to hear, it doesn't really help you. Because you probably did loads of good things on that project. So what was that good? What was not good? What do you need from me? What do you need is that fit? So, the rule of reciprocation. Anyone come across that? Okay, Dan has a couple of things. So, yeah, so the people sitting next to Dan essentially do this.
He did it so well.
Essentially, it states that if someone can do something to you, you feel the need to repay them back. It's kind of give and take. Give help, ask for help, give and take. And it's kind of like, I kind of think of it as when you're in the pub, when you're in the rounds. That's how you lose the connection. Someone does one round, you feel need to run around back. And it goes on and on and on. We talked about sun, so what did we talk about today?
Tea.
Okay, that's yours. You keep that one for yourself. But that's just a good point. Bring someone a cup of tea and ask for it. It's a nice thing to do. It then makes them feel like they own something. And it's all kind of basic psychology and all that stuff. But it works quite well. So, acknowledge and never dismiss or ignore. So by that, I mean, if you've ever had a scenario before where you come to someone's desk and they can't type an email or whatever it is, any type of question, and can't just do that. Keep typing. Have you ever done that to someone? Or have they done to you? I have, and it makes you feel like a speaker. It's not easy. If you're busy, you just say, can we catch up in 2 minutes? Some people just make you wait a while, it'll take 5 minutes to finish whatever they're doing. I know some people have experienced that. Have you experienced that? Yeah, I have. Usually I just walk away. But sometimes it is actually a power play. They need to send me away. So I'll send away to make. So, the example I had was from an automated tester in the team. She was a bit worried about some work that was being carried out that she deemed, well, wasn't necessary, but it was a technical task, and it wasn't even for what they were working on. And she flagged up that because she's the only one doing the automation, it will flag up other things, and they just basically dismissed her and just said, well, that's your job. And if I remember correctly, they actually laughed and said, well, that's your job, we're going to care. That's not a good thing to do. Especially to your own teammate. Assuming that only your bosses have valid opinions, or only your bosses should be listening to you. Again, if you have an idea, speak it. If you have some questions to ask, ask them, whether it's to your boss or not. And again, make your people wait. the reasons why he does anything like that. Beware of the curse of knowledge. Has anyone come across the curse of knowledge? No? So, it's a cognitive bias. And essentially, it's where you have the knowledge in your head. And you have trouble explaining. So, the way I think about it is music. If there's a song that you know that you'd like to know, and you want the title of it, whatever it is, and you're trying to explain it, usually you would go, you know that song, and the other day, it goes boo boo boo, blah blah blah, and then you just kind of use it, and you know what it's like. So, that's because the person can hear it in their heads. Probably you can see the person sing it, but the other person has no idea what you're talking about. Same thing, for example, with doctors and lawyers. So people that have the knowledge, and you're not aware of it. Again, something along the lines of software development. So if someone's trying to learn some programs, usually the developer will talk in quite high sort of technical knowledge or technical language, that's what he's used to or she's used to. Whereas someone's learning code is not going to know that, and if you really know what they want to experience that, does that make sense? Yeah? So it's the same thing. You have, again, you have to role as a specialist. That specialist is talking about something generally, you're not going to know what you're talking about because you're not a specialist. That person will have more knowledge than you. And just you take the time to explain it as one of the ways we can do that is talking about why does she care about something. That makes it a little easier. So for example, with code, is it all the top 10 people here or the limits of the code? Everyone's just like, is that just a mix of people or no, it's also a problem?
Mix.
Thank you. So, I'll still use an example of code, but if someone's trying to explain and say what a variable is, you might understand what it means, you don't know why you should care about that in terms of code. So explain to people why you should care about that. Reason being, you just feel rejected, you kind of give up. So, act as a sounding board. Be there just for someone to throw some ideas at you. So, again, something about that business, that's very good. I usually sit down with some other people when they're having a problem, and I can ask them questions. And I'm just there for them to ask them questions, so I just sit there. I won't touch them in the phone, I'll just act there in the sound board, when I have some ideas on things. And that works actually in the corner, it's not just something about me. Appreciate me, if someone offers you a piece, you take it on board. Again, don't just listen to people. Despite, obviously, rude, and again, I think that person will be quite small, and feel like their opinion is not valid.
Your behaviors are biased by your judgments and prejudices.
Yeah, your behaviors are based on your judgment and behaviors, that's, you know, sorry, your behaviors are based on your beliefs, yes. But that's essentially what someone there is saying.
So, I might believe that, yes. I always do a good job or something, so my behavior is to be conscientious.
Yeah, so you're going to be conscientious, yeah, because I'll do a good job. That's on the lines. So essentially, find people that like to do work rather than just get time to picture. They're quite easy to spot. You can usually find out in an interview in about 2 minutes. I remember one time I need to go ahead and ask this person who was a tester, what do you do to keep up to date? And he said, nothing. I said, well, you can at least lie, try lie, something, anything, just do nothing. That doesn't really tell me that you're passionate about what you do. That just tells me that you're in there for picture. If you're in there for picture, you might as well take the time and look at something you actually need and you enjoy doing. Because it makes your life feel better. Does that make sense? Yeah. Anyone disagree? By the way, Dan, how much time do I have? I don't know what time is that.
4 minutes.
4 minutes. Okay, cool. So, respectfully. It's basically taking the other point of view, or the other person's point of view, looking at the other person's angle, or just from a different angle altogether. So, for example, I had a friend of mine who was on a project. Through some miscommunication, he was let go, and he's a bit upset about that. But on the other hand, he'd been working with a whole new technology which he'd never worked before. So, essentially, well, yeah, you got let go, it wasn't your fault. into something emerged in the last couple of months, 3 months, 4 months. And I mean, what happened? It's the way we look at it. It's then you got back on the project and so you stick up anyway. But you might have been a bit angry about it and not come back on the project and maybe missed out with some more knowledge and working on this is a good choice. So just by taking a different perspective of the viewing ways, you felt better about it and then you ended up with that problem. So, invest your time talking to other people. You don't necessarily work in the same area. That's the best way to find information. It's just talking to other people. But I spend a lot of time in different companies actually talking to cleaners and security guards, because they know everything. You might think they're just standing there or just locking up at the table or they don't know. They'll let you know who's getting fired for that person. So everything's going on, they're all rumors. They hear it all, because people just ignore them.
Is it true? Is it helpful? Is it inspiring? Is it necessary? Is it kind? By kind, obviously.
conversation you've had in your lifetime where someone just went short or someone said that's a stupid idea, right? How did they make you feel? Or how did you feel? Not very good, right? Right? So just take that into account when you're talking to someone else as far as you know.
Shared donuts. Shared donuts.
Shared donuts. That's right. Yeah. That's the one that's my issue. Make test.
Toast.
There you go. Anyone else? One more? Say again? Yes. The rule of syndication. Kind of along the lines of the toast stuff and the donuts. Yeah. I'll do one more.
Inquisitive.
Ask questions. Awesome. Be the person to ask questions. Because if no one else might do it, you might miss out on something. Don't be embarrassed to ask questions. I learned very early on that if you do look stupid, it lasts for about 20 seconds. And then you go. Or if it's a case where you ask a question and everyone else knows, you uncover the communication error. So you look at why you're not going to ask that. So we looked at the models briefly. Oh, there it is. That's my model. Not your own name. Right, we looked at Melvin, we looked at Van Cheese, and we looked at Jackson Payne. Again, they're models. How we're going to agree through them, take what you think is useful, drop the rest. Revisit them again in 3 months, whatever, and see if that's useful or something useful. Models aren't the law, they're models. Take them and use them how you like. Think of them as paper. They say they're going to call a bunch of lists to see who's listening. Name one of those things from day to day. No one's listening, of course. One thing. We've covered some already, so don't repeat again. Don't say the liability word about it. Something new.
Listen.
One more. Fine. Was that something?
Break bread.
Awesome. Thank you. That is pretty much me. Those are the references. Any questions? No? Does anyone disagree with anything that we've covered?
Yeah.
Yes.
Not exactly disagreeing, but when you said we do it for a paycheck, everyone starts doing it for a paycheck at first.
Yeah, but I don't mean come work for free. But you have a choice between finding people that believe and enjoy what they're doing, and people that are just perhaps there, and people that are bills to pay. Well, bills to pay, but it's no reason to find people that don't actually like their job.
But you will always get a mix in the team of people working for a paycheck and people motivated by their jobs. Yeah. So maybe you can adapt with this, knowing each behavior, you can adapt and take the best out of each one.
Yeah, so that's, if you've got that person, then bring them in, engage them, build a relationship, find interest in them, move. That's what I was talking about differently. It all ties into it. But yes, generally I would rather look for someone that I know or I can see that has an interest in what they do, than someone that I might have to work on to get an interest in. Because you are a puppeteer, you are doing whatever. That's the next method. But yeah, if you're in a situation, I always are in my head. That makes sense?
Yep.
So I liked your model where you split out technical business and so on, but what happens if you get someone that's really good with the technical knowledge but doesn't fit with the team, but the knowledge is that good that you want them in the team?
Yeah, that's good. They're kind of like specialists for us, so you can have to look at different models and right? So if you've got someone who's very cynical, might need someone who's a little less cynical, but is good with the initial thinking, strategy, and direction.
What happens if
they're
not team players at all?
Well, then that's quite nice to sort of get it. So that would kind of, in the context of that one person, so we have to find out what interests them. They can sit yourself, as long as they come to the meeting and say, that's fine, not everyone's a good player. So you have to learn how to do it. And you can do that by using all the models and things that you want to discuss. That makes sense. That
yes.
I missed most of that. I was referencing something.
You're referencing for Arsenal, yeah. Can you give us some analogy of pre-five years in antimatter principle?
No, I've completely gone blank. I'd have to look up as well. But I don't want to talk about that. But it's one of those good solutions. I don't know how to put it in time words that makes sense. But it's good to know you can come across well. Are you around for a bit? Maybe we can talk about it over here, actually. Yeah?
Yeah, I was going to ask, what's the most successful team you've worked in and why was it successful?
One of the most successful ones I worked in was actually just down the street in the Monsoon Group, which is where that was. It's a team, and mainly I found that it's one of those places that was worked with or started with Douglas, and they worked with two team of characters. Douglas, who understood the importance of people that aren't or even before, knew about emotional functions and business. So that's, it was, for me, that was the best thing, because it took on board that they needed a different range of people, the way they think. So essentially what you find, sometimes you find, especially when you're kind of adult teams, is that everyone is over time. And so you miss out on the empathy side, or the emotional intelligence side. But if you get a good mix like that team was, then it works well. So I think there's just too much focus these days, often time, so.
The opposite to that question, so the worst team, maybe a team where you try to guarantee some of these principles and it just hasn't worked.
Yeah, so one of the worst teams was a couple years ago, and then where it's one of the teams where they literally sat this far apart and didn't talk to each other, they actually listened to each other and had some messaging. Because nobody was talking. When I was the first of all team, I think the evaluation of the test team, and I literally thought someone died because no one was talking. They literally sat this far apart, no words exchanged. And then I eventually joined that team to help them transition to doing more of an agile team. We started with breaking bread, so we started going out for lunch. And we started asking for them for getting their ideas, and feedback on those ideas. It's kind of baby steps, you just need to get people talking and asking questions. So essentially I started with breaking bread, asking for them to give them feedback. And then I gave them the confidence to actually start talking about my ideas and bringing a lot closer to the team.
Was that initially quite difficult to do that?
Yeah, it's not even the problems with agile transitions is that it's about times. I don't know if you've read is that people put a time frame on it? It's 6 months with the agile. It doesn't really work out. It's a consumer learning process, so continuous improvement. So a lot of the times you'll get consultants to come in and just try to go, we need to scrum. Don't explain why. Don't find out who's the best way to succeed. Don't look at what's happening in the team themselves and what individual skills people have. One of the toughest things I find is the time frame. But it is also, if you talk to people who work somewhere for 10, 15 minutes, never been asked their feedback or opinions, never even been able to talk to each other, don't know the names of everyone on their team, and it is a slow process, and it's just a slow process essentially. Because it's healthy to do, it doesn't work very well.
but do you think you need to be proactive in teaching people about your role as well? Because there's some companies might have a problem where there's misconceptions about what you're
doing. Can't depend on your actual role as well. So you do a lot of stuff in the background. But yes and no, so it kind of depends. If you come in there and say, I'm going to be with my transition, I'm going to be with my career, which again, some people might get fine, some people might get work, but it kind of depends on people around you and yourself. And how you want to work. You might even switch. You just go one way, it's a slight switch that way. So it kind of varies. It really depends on the people you're working with. Again, so if there's if there's a team that's been together for a year, that's probably easier for this situation and think of a different way. And say a team that's worked together for 10 years. So it varies from the team. It doesn't really help, but it's just kind of something you have to try and have. It's a trial and error.
Have a chat.